Little Hellhole Bay is located about 40 kilometers or 25 miles northeast of Charleston, South Carolina. The bay is barely visible in the LiDAR images due to the extensive erosion to which the terrain has been exposed from the time that the Carolina bays were emplaced. Most of the erosion is attributable to rainfall from hurricanes that frequently batter the Atlantic seashore. Welcome to another edition of the Carolina Bay of the Day, where we study the secondary impacts made by the glacierized boulders that were ejected by one or more extraterrestrial impacts on the Laurentide ice sheet by the Great Lakes. The secondary impacts produce seismic vibrations that liquefied unconsolidated soil, and the oblique impacts of glacier ice created inclined conical cavities that became shallow elliptical basins by viscous relaxation. In Nebraska, these basins are called rainwater basins, and along the Atlantic coastal plain, they are called Carolina Bays. Little Hellhole Bay is a well-formed Carolina Bay in the Francis Marion Forest Preserve, but the U.S. Geological Survey seems to include the surrounding swamp areas in the definition of Little Hellhole Bay. The rim of this bay is very faint and of low relief. The southern part of the rim of the bay can be seen clearly in the LiDAR imagery, but a heavy forest canopy obscures the northern half of the bay. The neighboring landscape does not have many Carolina Bays. The area where Little Hellhole Bay is found, colored pink, is at about 20 meters above sea level. Hellhole Swamp to the east, colored blue, is at about 22 meters above sea level. There seems to be only one Carolina Bay in this vast area, and its rims are almost gone. The terrain is higher than the storm surges from hurricanes that can reach heights of 6 meters. The erosion can be attributed to rainfall from storms and persistent wet conditions that tend to level the ground. This area is called Hellhole Swamp because it is really a nasty place. From June through August, which is the wettest season, much of the ground is usually submerged in 2 to 18 inches of standing water. On September 21, 1989, Hurricane Hugo swept through with winds in excess of 135 miles per hour, devastating decades-old second-growth forest. Virtually every tree that reached 9 inches in diameter fell to earth, and trails and old roads were washed away. A guide to the Wilderness Park says that insects abound, with mosquitoes, chiggers, and ticks reaching peak irritability from summer through fall. Many snakes, including poisonous water moccasins, copperheads, and rattlesnakes, make their homes here. Visibility is poor within most of the areas due to the dense vegetation, and it is easy to get lost. There are very few spots dry enough for camping. If you desire a true South Carolina wilderness adventure, bring shoes that will hold up when wet, insect repellent, and courage. The Francis Marion National Forest is named for Revolutionary War hero Francis Marion, who was known to the British as the Swamp Fox. The quadrilateral area and the J-shaped channel in the middle of the bay is the result of many conservation projects involving state and federal organizations that have worked under the North American Waterfowl Management Plan. The area where Little Hellhole Bay is located has rims of Carolina Bays that are about to disappear. It is important to understand how water erosion washes away the rims of the Carolina Bays, because the absence of bays on some terraces has been interpreted as a method of deducing their time of emplacement. Determining the rate of erosion of the Carolina Bays could be used to determine the age of the bays in the same way that the rate of decay is used for radioisotope dating. The glacier ice impact hypothesis proposes that the Carolina Bays originated as secondary impacts by ice boulders ejected by an extraterrestrial impact on the Laurentide ice sheet 12,900 years ago. The Carolina Bays are elliptical conic sections because they originated as penetration funnels, which are inclined conical cavities. Experiments confirm that this mechanism is plausible. The presence of Carolina Bays on terraces of different ages can potentially be used to determine the time of creation of the Carolina Bays. In North Carolina, the Pamlico Terrace, at an elevation of 7 meters above sea level, has many Carolina Bays, but the Princess Anne Terrace, at 4 meters above sea level, does not have any bays at all. The logical conclusion seems to be that at one time all the surface in this area was covered with Carolina Bays prior to 100,000 years ago, but when the sea level increased and covered the Princess Anne Terrace 40 to 80,000 years ago, all the bays in the lower terrace were eroded. This could indicate that the Carolina Bays are more than 100,000 years old, and therefore they cannot be associated with the Younger Dryas impact 12,900 years ago. It is important to note that the Princess Anne Terrace is at 4 meters above mean sea level and can be easily flooded by storm surges that can reach up to 6 meters above sea level. This would be enough to completely erode the base in the lower terrace without affecting the base on the higher Pamlico Terrace. The National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration keeps historical hurricane tracking data. This image shows the paths of hurricanes in North America during the past 150 years. The east coast of the United States is constantly battered by hurricanes. Georgia and the Carolinas show the largest concentration of hurricane landfalls along the Atlantic coast. Even if only 2 hurricanes per year made landfall in the Atlantic seashore, during a period of 12,000 years, there would be a total of 24,000 hurricanes, many of which could have produced storm surges capable of destroying Carolina Bays and terrain below 4 meters above sea level. Little Hellhole Bay and Hellhole Swamp are at 20 to 22 meters above sea level, so the reason for the erosion of these bays cannot be attributed to storm surges. The erosion is most likely caused by the torrential rainfall associated with hurricanes, bioturbation by tree roots and burrowing animals, and the consistently wet conditions of the soil that eventually transform the muddy ground into a level field by viscous relaxation under the force of gravity. These images of Carolina Bays located 12 kilometers south of Mullins, South Carolina, were taken 78 years apart. The terrain is about 13 meters above sea level and 55 kilometers inland from the Atlantic Ocean. The broad sandy rims that were so evident in the 1942 image are just faintly visible today due to the high rate of erosion. There are multiple lines of evidence that the Carolina Bays originated 12,900 years ago at the onset of the Younger Dryas cooling event. This LiDAR image of Long Island shows red circles in areas with Carolina Bays. Removing the LiDAR image, but retaining the red circles where the Carolina Bays are found, we have a USGS map showing the moraines left by the glaciers that retreated from Long Island about 18,000 years ago. The Carolina Bays could not have formed while Long Island was covered by glaciers. This means that the Carolina Bays were in place sometime after 18,000 years ago. This represents the earliest date at which the bays could have formed. In 2012, Ted Bunch and 17 co-authors were looking for evidence of a cosmic airburst or impact 12,900 years ago. In the rim of a Carolina Bay near Blackville, South Carolina, they took samples for optically stimulated luminescence at 107, 152, and 183 centimeters below the surface. The layer at 107 centimeters had an age of 11.5 thousand years. The layer at 152 centimeters had a date of 18.5 thousand years, and the layer at 183 centimeters had a date of 12.96 thousand years. This inverted stratigraphy is expected for the rim of an impact structure as illustrated in the inset from the book Impact Cratering by Professor Milosh. The layer at a depth of 183 centimeters corresponds to the original ground surface at the time of the emplacement of the Carolina Bays. The date of 12.96 thousand years correlates with the onset of the Younger Dryas impact event. Another way of estimating the date of creation of the Carolina Bays is to consider the ecological effect of bay formation. This image shows an area of 4 square kilometers with many overlapping bays in Marlboro County, South Carolina. When we add the energy required to create the Carolina Bays, we get a total of 31,794 kilotons or 31.8 megatons of TNT. That corresponds to an energy of 7.95 megatons per square kilometer. The saturation bombardment by the ice boulders ejected by the extraterrestrial impact on the Laurentide ice sheet covered an area from the Rocky Mountains to the east coast of the United States. Megafauna like the mammoths, short-faced bears, giant armadillos, and all the forest plants hit by these large ice pieces would have been obliterated. This chart shows the extinctions during the last 56,000 years. Many animals went extinct at the Younger Dryas boundary 12,900 years ago. There are other extinctions in this 56,000-year time interval, but the most sudden and severe extinction is at the onset of the Younger Dryas. Approximately 45 genera disappeared along with the Clovis people who populated America at that time. The extraterrestrial impact was followed by a cold period lasting approximately 1,300 years that caused further extinctions of a species that survived the impact but could not adapt to the new environmental conditions. The rapid rate at which the Carolina Bays are being eroded indicates that these fragile sandy ellipses are relatively new geological structures and that they probably originated from secondary impacts of one or more extraterrestrial impacts on the Laurentide Ice Sheet 12,900 years ago. Thank you for joining me in the investigation of the Carolina Bays and the Younger Dryas Cataclysm. I will continue to examine the Carolina Bays one bay at a time. My book about the Carolina Bays is available at Amazon. Please subscribe to my YouTube channel to be notified of future videos about the Carolina Bays.